Hello and welcome. My name is Softwacker and this is Softwacker's SevTech Survival Strategy Guide. Yes, I know. In this video, I want to show you the best tips and tricks that might help you with your start in SevTech Ages. And those are the combination of helpful tricks that are useful in Age Zero or in general throughout the game. So this is the basic, the starting guide, stuff that you really want to know when you did start. I'm a YouTuber, I'm a streamer, and I have played SevTech, and I finished it somewhat. In H5, the world bugged out, and I had to stop. But I had a lot of fun with it, I learned a lot of things, and I want to share my wisdom with you. This is, of course, not a complete list. This is just things that I personally found really helpful. So there are lots of more things out there. And I'm going to show you where to find those things as well, just so if you want to read more. Before we start, just one other disclaimer, one big thank you to my community that helped me to collect more and more tricks, that helped me to build this world where we're going to shoot this video in, because it's actually a creative server. Also, a big shout out to Reddit, to the SevTech subreddit, where lots of tips and tricks are shared, lots of inspiration can come from there. And in there, somebody also created a tricks page where you can read up through all the tricks that have been collected. I'm gonna link this page and subreddit in the bottom, in the description, so we can go there and also in the comments, so you have access to it. But without further ado, let's get right into it. And here we are with chapter one. If you have started playing SevTech already, you might have noticed that the chess situation in the beginning, in the early game, is kind of dire. For those who haven't played it yet, in the beginning you don't have a normal chest, you don't have a normal workbench, you have different tools, so you're starting really out in a tribal workspace where everything is kind of limited. So you start off with this chest here, which is easily done. I mean, it's more expensive than a regular chest, but the problem with that one is it doesn't have an inventory, it doesn't have an interface, so you have to pick up items from here and put them then into different slots in there. You have 12 slots where you can store items, and overall it is difficult. I mean, you can close them up, but overall it is weird to work with it. Then the next chest would be the primal chest, which takes some dark wood, so you have to find the dark lens, but you do that in your tutorial, so that's no problem. And then you can make a bigger chest, which is actually smaller. It has now an interface, but only 9 slots. And now with the normal chest, then you can actually make the primal chest advanced. And there, you have slightly more specs. It is overall not good. So it is very limiting in the beginning, and that was one of the few very frustrating points for me when I started playing it. But there is actually a solution. And the solution is right behind me. The cards. You can build cards fairly simple. All you need is some wheels, which is the sticks and wood. Then you need 2 advanced chests and a bit more wood and wood slabs. That's all. That's all you need. And the card is now a double chest. So, I would highly recommend that when you have the materials to spare, which you should have at that stage, you do make a card in order to use it. The card has some more uses. There are 2 cards in there, actually. One card is the normal card. That is the one that I'm having here. Or you have the transportation card, which is to transport animals. You just push some animals in there, or villagers, or whatever, and you can transport them around through the world. And also, with both cards, you can take a horse and drag the cart around with all the inventory attached. So that is another good point why you should use cards instead of normal chests or those early game chests. It is super helpful, it is super simple, and I can only recommend doing it. If you want to use the horse and the cards, you have to set up a keybind in order to... So basically what you do is you ride your horse. You ride your horse in front of the cart, press the button, and then the cart attaches to your horse, and there we go. And same button to detach the horse. That's it. Very helpful, very simple. There is a few things that you need to keep in mind. However, First of all, those cards are not protected by land claims, by the usual land claims. So people might have access to it and you have no way to really lock it. But it's only important for multiplayer servers. And also, when you write your card over some fauna, let's say Sakakte or something that damages it, it could break the card and the stuff is flying around. So keep that in mind, that might be a problem. And of course, it has a will of its own. Stop it. Stop moving around. Okay. I'm gonna fix that later. The transportation card, same thing. Again, you can push pets and villagers into it, and then they'll just go up there, and then you can carry them around as well. So, also keep in mind that when you use the merge to nearby chest button or deposit to nearby chest, it will not detect cards as chests. So this is another downside from using those cards. But overall, I think they are still the best choice in H0. In chapter 2, it's all about a dog's life. But in order to use this trick to its full extent, we have to put in some work. So let's go right to it. First of all, start harvesting manzanita bushes, brown turkey tails, or tumbleweeds. Grind those plants into brown powder. Use the brown powder together with plant vines and insects to make a fluid bladder. Find and harvest some rice. Grind rice into rice flour. Find some salt. Collect water with the fruit bladder. Combine it with rice and salt to rice dough. Combine rice dough with the bladder to get a rice slime ball. Find some hemp. Grind the hemp in the millstone. Use shears to collect feathers from chicken. Craft the hemp fibers plus feathers into a bundle of feathers. Kill a dog to get his pelt. Make some leather shoes, and I'm not going into leather shoes big now because the whole leather thing is an entire different story, but that will be taught in the tutorial, so I'm not touching that at all right here. So, craft some leather boots, get your dog pelts, two rice slime balls, and a bundle of feathers to make you the wild dog boots. And here we are, that's all we need. The wild dog pelt boots are, in my opinion, the strongest boots in the game. They have several good features. So this is me running now, okay? Pretty cool. This is me running with the dog boots. This is not creative mode, this is normal survival mode. Plus, they got a jump boost. Plus, no fall damage. Those shoes are, in my opinion, the best shoes that you can have. And I was wearing my boots right up until I could was able to fly. Because until then, they are the best shoes that you can have. There are no other shoes that I would consider being more helpful. You can repair them with normal dog pelts. So you don't have to craft them all again every time. So just get as soon as you have an anvil, you can just repair them and then have run speed, jump boost, and no falling damage forever. Perfect shoes, in my opinion. You should always have them on. And here we are at chapter 3. Some small quality of life changes or tips that might help you getting along better in your Septic Zero world. And the first tip that I have for you is just go sleep and then die. Just die. Why? That's fairly simple. Because now you have a compass that leads you to your home. Make sure, however, that you have set your spawn point, or that you have set your spawn point right where your base is. And even though you are now, if you're picking up your grave, even afterwards, the compass will still show to that point in your world. You see it? And a tooltip as well in my hand. Well, not right now in my hand, but you can see it moving. So this compass will now show this specific place on the world every time, regardless where you are. Which means you have a very good compass to find your way home, since we don't have a map yet. And don't have journey map, etc. This is just me for the tutorial. So the death compass is one of the very easy way. And a very good way to find a way back to your to your base. Another cool thing that is available on the in this mod pack is the carry on mod. The carry on mod allows you to just pick up and carry the most machines and most inventories. Like, example, I have a chest here and I want to transport it. I can just shift right click and then I'm gonna carry over the chest and with all its inventory. Very easy. I can do it with machines, I can do it with barrels full of water, for example. I can do it with animals, and there's a lot of things that you can just sneak right click on it to pick it up in order to carry it around and place it where you want to. So highly recommended to use it wherever it makes sense. For the next week, imagine you are standing somewhere in a mineshaft where you're falling down a ravine and have no idea how to get out. Well, it is fairly simple. You just you take the work blade in your hand and shift right click on a block, and every here and then it will become a ladder block. So we can now crawl up the wall up until the very top. And especially in combination with the dog boots, where you have no falling damage, this is a very nice combination to get around. And it works with the majority of blocks. For example, with cobblestone, it works with granite, it works with netherrack, it works with endstone even. Although I don't know how often you will use that in the end. But it works with the majority of blocks. Another cool way is to use dirt to make dirt stairs. I need more dirt. It has to be fresh dirt. It cannot be grass. But you can make then dirt stairs, which is also a very cool way to get around. Especially, let's say, if you want to have a mineshaft and the normal stairs are a bit too expensive for you, or you don't want to spend stone on it. So that's also a cool way to get around. So the workblade here for ladders or stairs. One of the most tedious works in the early age stages is it to hammer iron bars, or it comes later on, or to craft some wood with the chopping block. There is, however, a way to make it very quick. So what you do is you take your wood in your offhand, you take the flint hatchet in your main hand, you hold the right button down and then just click with the left one all the time. There we go. And that way you can fairly easy chop some wood. So that makes the whole process a bit easier. Make sure that you stand slightly on the chopping block so that you cannot place a second chopping block or a second wood block on top of it. So just like this, and there you go. And that way it allows you to fairly easily chop some wood. Later on, you can make a construction like this one. You have the automated chopping block, you have a hopper on top and hover on the button, and it's just there, which then allows you to automatically fill in some wood. But until then, this is a very cool alternative, very easy one, and I would highly recommend using that wherever it's possible. And you made it to chapter 4, where we're gonna take a look at some waterworks, I would say. First of all, there's one thing that you need to know, and this is very important when you select your base. Water does not regenerate in Minecraft in Septic Ages. So you see here, I picked up some water and it doesn't regenerate. There are only two exceptions for that, and that is if you are in a river or ocean biome. Like, you can see it on my map right now. I'm now at a river biome, and in here water does come back, but only in river and ocean biomes. So you want to have your base near a river biome so you have access to water. And as I was saying early on, what I was doing is I would be getting water in a barrel, because you have no tanks yet, fill it up, and then use the carry-on mod to carry the water into my base. So, and this way I would then be able to use the water in my base, let's say, for making some leather or similar things. And while you're already at it, why not build a few of those fine strainer bases? The strainer base itself is not really too expensive, too extravagant. It's just a bit of wood and a wooden hopper. So it is definitely doable, and it brings a lot of, it helps a lot. The strainer allows you to put in some nets there. And there are two types of nets. You have the survivalist strainer and the dense strainer. Both are coming in different quality, which only determines the efficiency and the uses that it have. So the survivalist strainer just needs a bit of a net, which is some string plus some wood. So that's pretty easy. the solid strainer already need then some iron and do, yeah, you get the idea. So the difference between those normal strainers and those this normal strainers and the dense strainer is the amount or the stuff that they're getting. The normal strainer only get you stone, clay, wood and sticks, which is pretty powerful. And the survivalist strainer gives you gravel, sand, dirt, ink sacks, which you need for dog pelt boots, for example. The shark tooth, which you also need for several good things. And allows you to... Oops, oh no. I broke it. And allows you to get those things out of your system. The last net that you have is the fisherman's trainer. And this one is a bit different because it does not break. But it only works if there is bait in the system. So you don't need a bait pot. The bait pot is pretty simple. You just need a net and a flower pot, which gives you a bait pot. But you don't need this one. What you need is a normal bait. And the normal bait is also not so bad. So you get the trowel, the garden trowel. There are two. This one is, I believe, yeah. This one is fairly simple. You need a stick, a flint, and dirt. And you repair this one with dirt in your inventory. So once you have it once, you never need a new one. And then you just go through some dirt and just dig it up. You can dig it up, place it again, etc. And while doing so, you get the bait. You can see those worms. But you also, even from dirt, get flint. So just by digging up some stuff, you also get the stuff that you need to repair your trowel before it breaks. There we go. There's some flint. Now I can use the flint and repair my trowel, and there we go. So I would highly recommend the garden trowel. Is fast. It gives you lots of stuff, and I would highly recommend using it instead of a normal shovel, because then you don't need any other shovel anymore. And then you just put in the bait into the bait slot, and now for 10 baits it will catch something. It will basically just be a fisher. So you get some fish, you get some junk. You don't get any enchantment books or any other junk or name tags, but I mean, what you get already is pretty powerful. So I would highly recommend build those trainers. I mean, you just need one and then just rotate the net every here and there. You can just take the net. Oh, Jesus. You can just take the net out and there we go. And put another net in. That's pretty simple. Okay. So here we are. Here the different things that you can get out from the nets. There we go as well. So yeah, find a water biome. Settle down there, get a strainer, and you have a lot of passive material generation, which is, especially at that stage, very rare. So use it. And now to chapter 5, where I'm going to show you some things that you might not want to do in Septic Ages. You know that when you're running around, you see lots of those funny little pebbles running around, lying around, and you kind of need them for crafting something, so you're inclined, and also they kind of look messy, so you want to get rid of them, right? So I highly encourage you to not do that. The reason for that is pretty simple. Those rocks are not just some rocks. They are actually indicators of materials to come in the future. Let's say I'm going to add myself stage 1 now. So this is how it looks like when you are completely fresh into the game. And suddenly, those rocks turn into some samples, which allow me to see that in this chunk is a specific material. And with every stage that you're unlocking, there are more samples. And if I break this one, if I would have broken the stone, the sample would not be shown anymore. So if I clear out a chunk from all samples, I have no indicator what material, what resources are underground. So you have to be really careful what stones to remove. And there is a slight trick to that. All you want to do is, you want to click a stone once. Just go there and right click the stone once. Left click. So, if it breaks in one click, then it is just a normal stone. If it does not break with a single click, then it is something else. Okay, so only if you can break the stone in one single click, then it is not a sample. Okay? So let's add some more stages. So, there we go. You see, those things are all samples. This is still a normal stone. And only if you can break them in a single click, then it is just a stone. Otherwise, it is an ore sample. So leave it where it is until you can see what the ore actually is that you're looking at. Okay? Highly recommended that you do this. Another thing that you shouldn't do is, please do not trample farm places. If you see a farm place, farmland in the open world, do not touch it. You can harvest it, of course, if you want to. And you can even seed, place a seed again on it if you want to. So harvest, reseed. Perfect. But do not trample it. In the early game, you have no option to create farmland yourself. So those things are actually pretty valuable. So if you see some, keep in mind or try to remember where they are and use them to, for example, plant some rice or whatever you need in order to build the stuff that you want to have. Later on, when you can build your farm places, that's pretty fine. But until then, don't touch them. Just leave them as they are. And here we are at the last chapter of this video where I want to show a bit more about Totemic, which I think was the best addition to Sevtek. I really enjoyed playing with Totemic and see what it can do. And also stuff that you do in here is useful up until stage 3 and 4 easily. Totemic is a mod where it's all about totems, rituals, singing and dancing and doing all the weird stuff. And my first recommendation is, as soon as you can, get those carving knife. Get those totem whittling knife and have it with you at all times. And also always have a bit of wood or place some, yeah, or maybe find trees in your area. What the totems do is they give you a set of different buffs depending on what totems you have carved in a range of 6x6x6. So in a spheric area. Right now I don't have a buff. I step into the range of a totem and I suddenly get the speed buff from the horse totems that I have here. And also if I get closer, I get the Enderman. There we go. The fire resistance comes from the totem, and there's night vision coming from the Enderman totem on top. Again, 6x6x6 is the range. The different abilities that you have is very well described in the book that you craft, where you have falling damage, you have blaze with fire resistance, strength, creepers, luck, haste bonus, and lots of different things that you can use. So feel free to experiment with that one. The ones that I think are most helpful are, for example, those horse totems with an Enderman on top. With an Enderman and Ocelot on top, or even in between. So the bonus here is that you can get, and also keep in mind, you can build them into the ground so they don't have to stand on solid ground. You can build them a bit deeper and build them up so they still give you the buff, but they don't stand too high. What this totem does is six horse totems, one Ocelot and one Enderman. It gives you a speed bonus in your base, plus night vision, and it prevents creepers from exploding due to the Ocelot. Having those totems all around your base is pretty helpful, so you basically have permanent speed, permanent night vision, and you are safe from creepers. So highly recommend this one for your bases. For the entrance of your bases, like when you have a farm that you want to use or you want to clear an area, I would recommend using a totem pole of 6 cows and also then using the wolf carving. Let me just go for the cow, Enderman, Ocelot pick. There we go. So right now I have, due to the buffaloes here, I have the haste bonus and I have resistance and slowness from the cow. But I have resistance 4. So resistance 4 is a very strong buff. And now I can carve a wolf. One wolf gives me strength 1. There we go. Two wolves will give me strength 2, no, I don't believe, no, it needs to be 2, so there we go, we got strength 2, and then 6 wolves give me strength 3, So, with those two totems in a fighting area, I have resistance 4 and strength 3. And that's really helpful if you need to fight a lot. If you have a mining area, you might want to use the buffalo totems instead and just get haste bonus. The haste bonus does not affect the core samples later on. It affects only, like, say, redstone, coal, lapis, and stuff like this. So you don't need the pick all the time, but I would highly recommend using the buffalo totem. And again, it's so simple. You just build your mineshaft, place down 3-4 wood blocks, and carve the buffalo in there, and then you can mine around it. So highly recommended to use that as often as you can. What Totemic also does is it allows you to play certain rituals by hitting on drums, wind chimes, flutes, and stuff like this. There are different rituals, they're all described in the book, I'm not going through them right now. There are a few things that are helpful in combination with those rituals. First of all, there are two rituals where you have to summon or change something. For example, there's a ritual where you change a cow into a buffalo. This becomes really helpful when you have a moat around your totem. So you can still activate from this area, you can still activate the ceremony. The ceremony will always be linked to a totem close to this instrument, so you have to be in range of it. And the cows will be in here and will be then transformed into buffaloes, and they don't run away, so you have no problems with that. There's another ritual where you summon an ancient bow skeleton fighter, and this guy is really tough. However, if you summon him in a construct like this, he will fall down into the moat and cannot escape because he cannot jump too high, and then you can just easily defeat him by maybe cutting a hole into the wall or whatever it is. So don't be like me and just summon him in the wild and then run away for the next half an hour because he is catching on to you and trying to lure him into a moat in the end anyway. There is, however, one ritual that I would highly recommend you to study and learn and use it as often as possible. And you can find it, let me just go back. Ceremonies. And what I'm talking is the Sefkil Walls. The Sefkil Walls is causing plants nearby to grow faster. And that is kind of an understatement. Let me show you exactly how what I mean. To activate the Sefkil Walls, you need to hit the wind chime and otherwise a flute. It only has two notes, so which means it is not too difficult to achieve. So in order to activate the Sefkil Walls, you shift right click a wind chime, then shift right click your flute, and there goes it. Then put your wind chime in the offhand, take a rattle, and then just drum, rattle, and dance away. And you can see, you have to fill the upper blue bar before the lower blue bar runs out, which is pretty simple. It's not a complicated ritual, but now, around the totem, the crops are growing like crazy. Like absolute madness crazy. You can see it here. This is a ritual, I have no idea why it is so strong, but I would highly recommend that you learn that one and use it as often as you need it, because it is really just so powerful. Highly recommended. The Sefkil Walls, ladies and gentlemen. You see, it is just running half time now, and I'm getting crops and stuff. It's just pure madness, and it's all around the area of the totem where the growth is happening. So highly recommended to learn this walls at least. And that's it. Those were my 6 chapters of Softwrecker Sevtek Survival Strategy Guide, where I have shown some tips and tricks that helped me a lot in Age 0. There will be more videos for Age 1 to 5. Not sure when exactly, because we're still working on them. But I hope this video helped you to enjoy your playthrough a little bit more. And if yes, feel free to leave a like. I wouldn't recommend subscribing to my channel if you're just speaking English, because my channel is mostly German, so you would be having lots of unnecessary pings. However, if you have a tip and trick that I haven't mentioned yet, or something that you really liked, or something else, just leave a comment for everybody else that is watching the video, or read through the comment section and see if there are more tips and tricks that might be helpful for you to share the collective wisdom of the modern Minecraft community. I thank you much for watching, have a nice day, and enjoy Sevtek Ages. Bye!